But right now, at 15 minutes past the hour, how is the security of airports going to change?
Can we ever get back to the safety we once felt when traveling the once friendly skies?
Joining us now from our Washington, D.C. Bureau is director of globalsecurity.org, John Pike. Good morning.
Good morning.
Well, you know, we talk about beefing up security at the airports. But on the flip side of that, we know that some of the people involved in the attacks on Tuesday had ramp passes, fake IDs, and perhaps fake uniforms as well. Can we ever beef up security enough to be completely safe?
Well, we're never going to be completely safe. If you want to be safe, you ought to just stay at home in bed. But there's obviously a tremendous amount that the United States can do to improve our security.
Such as?
One thing very obvious is going to be to make sure that you have a complete matchup between the people on the airplane and the baggage on the airplane. It's routine in Europe that all the passengers have to get off the airplane and reclaim their baggage if there's a mismatch. The good news for American passengers, of course, is that lost baggage is going to be a thing of the past. We need to make sure that the cockpit doors are locked before you let passengers on. I think they're going to be focused on biometric identification, using computers to do facial scans to identify people rather than simply relying on uniforms or ID badges, which can obviously be stolen or faked. The fundamental thing I think they're going to have to think about, though, is what is the nature of the threat? What have we learned here? Because in the past, the threat was basically thought to be one or two people probably acting alone, and that at the end of the hijacking episode, no more than one or two people were going to be dead as a result. Now we're faced with a very different threat, where potentially you could have a couple of dozen people involved, and where there's a very real probability that all of the passengers are going to be killed and a lot of people on the ground. And that leads you to very different strategies for how the flight crew deals with the hijacking episode.
Yeah, John, you know, perhaps the United States should use the Israeli model, where they've got some of the greatest security with their El Al airline.
Right.
You know, where they've got sky marshals and
and so forth and so on. One of the big problems, of course, is that the United States is not Israel. El Al has absolutely outstanding security. El Al also flies a limited number of flights over very long distances. Mm-hmm. And the notion that people are going to go to an American airport, spend 3 hours getting through security in order to take a 45-minute flight, I think is difficult to believe. Amtrak is clearly going to become a much more attractive option for flying up and down, for traveling up and down the East Coast.
I have to stop you when you talk about locking the doors. Those paper-thin doors, they don't cut it anymore.
Absolutely.
I mean, I'm talking about the doors to the cockpit. I mean, that has to change. I mean, I would hope that that could change on a massive level with federal support almost immediately. Can that be done?
Well, I think that this is one of the things that's already changed, that previously the airport security, airline security, was basically something that the airlines themselves were responsible for. They've obviously been in an enormously cutthroat competitive marketplace. They've been cutting costs, and as far as security is concerned, they've been cutting corners. Now that we're faced with a national terrorist threat, I think that the national government is going to have to accept responsibility for the costs of ensuring our security on those planes.
But you don't want to dump on the airlines too much. I mean, I know that at least one of the people who was on board the airline was on an INS watch list. So it seems like there's also a lot of coordination that has to be improved.
Well, the INS has been in the process of upgrading their computer system to make it easier for them to monitor the whereabouts of people on those lists. They obviously have a very far journey to travel in that direction. And hopefully some of this $40 billion that's been appropriated is going to go to that as well. There are a number of agencies that are responsible for different pieces of the Homeland Security puzzle. Generally, they haven't had the sort of coordination that's going to be required in the weeks and months ahead.
You know, one of the things about what has happened, John, is that the terrorists use really low-tech devices of terror. They use plastic knives and they use box cutters, which had just blades 1 inch long. But what it comes down to is, when I remember back when people used to hijack airplanes before it was take me to Havana, it was never that they would crash an airplane loaded with fuel into a high rise.
Right, and I think that that's one of the fundamental procedural changes that you're going to have here, because Until this week, the air crews were basically indoctrinated to cooperate with the hijacker,
right.
Because the pattern was that if you cooperate with the hijacker, no one's going to get killed. I think from here on out, the theory is going to be that unless you do something quickly, everyone on the plane is going to get killed and a lot of people on the ground. But I think that the big problem that we have is that in looking at terrorism and looking at post-Cold War security threats, people have been way too focused on these high-end threats like nuclear-tipped missiles and missile defense, maybe too focused on the biological threat, not nearly focused enough on hijacking
right.
an airplane.
So you're saying that in the past, the correct thing to do was to just give in to their demands. Ultimately, what brought all those planes down was opening the cockpit door. Did the pilots do the right thing by doing that?
I don't think we have any idea what happened on those airplanes until we get a look at the recorders.
And the good news is, thank you very much. We really appreciate your insight, and it's hard to imagine a more valuable guest at this point, because sooner or later, most of us have to fly at some point. We want to feel safe. Thanks again.
Thank you.